بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، حبيب إله العالمين، أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد، وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألف لام ميم. تلك آيات الكتاب الحكيم، هدى ورحمة للمحسنين، الذين يقيمون الصلاة ويؤتون الزكاة وهم بالآخرة هم يوقنون، أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم المفلحون. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. As we continue with the tafsir of Surah Luqman, chapter 31 in the Quran, we first see the verses. The first verse in the Quran is Alif Lam Mim. Now there are 29 chapters in the Quran, surahs in the Quran, that begin with disconnected letters. It begins with letters, Arabic letters, like Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim, or Kaf Ha Ya Ain Sad in Surah Maryam, or Surah Yasin, Ya Sin, Surah Taha, Taha. And there are 29 chapters in the Quran that begin with the disjointed, the حروف المقطعات. And the majority of them, 27 of the 29, were revealed in Mecca, and only two of those chapters with the مقطعات, with the disconnected letters, were revealed in Medina, and those were Al-Baqarah and Al-Imran. All of the other chapters that begin with disconnected letters were revealed in Mecca. Now, these disjointed and disconnected letters, they have mesmerized commentators. Many commentators, they give many opinions as to what these disconnected letters mean. One group, they say, these are from the mutashabihat. The Quran has clear verses and ambiguous verses. The ambiguous verses, they say that it is not our task, it is not our job to come and try to analyze them and see them, and we shouldn't play guessing games. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is the true meaning of these حروف المقطعات. A different group of scholars, another group, and perhaps the majority, they say that the Qur'an was revealed for a purpose. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Qur'an in order to deliver a message to us, in order to tell us, in order to speak to us. Now yes, we might not understand certain things, certain meanings in the Qur'an. However, that doesn't mean that it doesn't have a meaning. And then from there on, they began to give many meanings and interpretations and possibilities as to what these حروف المقطعات mean. One opinion says these are the names of God. These are the names of Allah. Alif, Lam, Mim, Kaf, Ha, Ya, Ain, Sad, Alif, Lam, Ra. These are the names of God. Another is that these are the letters of Ismullah al-A'zam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a great name where when you call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that name, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer you. So one opinion says that these حروف المقطعات, they are letters from Ismullah al-A'zam. Another opinion says that these are letters which describe the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for example, alif, it describes, it begins with Allah. Lam, the L, describes the lutf and the compassion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mim describes the majd and the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, the Qur'an can have more than one meaning. The Qur'an can have several meanings. إِنَّ لِلْقُرْآنِ بَطْنٍ وَلِبَطْنِ الْقُرْآنِ بَطْنٍ. The Qur'an has an internal meaning, and the internal aspect of it also has another internal meaning, and many meanings. So it could be very much a possibility that all of these are true, because we have some hadith from the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, which they describe that, for example, the A, the Alif, describes Allah, the Lam describes the Lutf, and the Mim describes the Majd. And we also have other narrations which may describe other things, other things that have to do with this life. But of course, we are in no position to do tafsir of the Quran on our own. We need to refer to the Imam. We need to refer to the Ma'soom, the infallibles. They are the ones who understand the Qur'an. Therefore, they have the right to give us various interpretations of one verse. One meaning of these letters is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to us, humans. And one of the qualities that differentiates the humans from all other creation is that we have the ability to communicate. We have the ability to connect with one another. Now yes, the animals, other creation, they also do communicate. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is communicating with us in a language that we understand, in a language that we comprehend. And especially the Quran was being revealed to the Arabs in Mecca. And the Arabs, they were very proud of one thing. There were many things that they were not proud of. They used to kill, they used to oppress, they used to abuse. But there was one thing that made them proud, and that was their Arabic language. That was the eloquence of their language and their poetic skills. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is revealing these verses in Mecca. And as we mentioned, the chapters that were revealed in Mecca are proving the faith. They're more focused on ideological concepts. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying Alif, Lam, Mim, Kaf, Ha, Ya, Ayn, Sad. These are the letters of your language. You should comprehend what is being said in the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins by showing us letters that we understand, letters that we use to communicate with one another. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins to speak to us. So imagine someone, they want to speak to you in English, and they're talking to you, but you don't understand what's being said. So they come and they tell you A, B, C. These are letters that you are familiar with. And then therefore, then after that, they begin talking to you in a language that you are familiar with. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Quran that we send every prophet to every people, to every group of people, we send to them a prophet that speaks to them in their own language. It wouldn't make sense if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a prophet that does not speak in the language that we understand and we comprehend. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the surah, Alif, Lam, Mim, these are the letters and these are the possible meanings of the letters that we mentioned. تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْكِتَابِ الْحَكِيمِ. These are the signs and the verses of the book that is Hakim, the book that is wise. Now, scholars point out that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says تِلْكَ, this is referring to something that is far. إِشَارَ إِلَى الْبَعِيدِ. When you say هَذَا, when you point at something close, you say هَذَا. But if you're pointing at something far, you say tilka. So when far, how is this far? These are the signs of Allah. These letters, one interpretation says, these letters are letters that are difficult for our minds and our intellects to grasp. And the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, some of them we could grasp and we could easily understand. and there are others that we cannot easily understand. So Allah says, Alif Lam Mim, Tilka Ayatul Kitab Al Hakim. These are the far-fetched signs where it's difficult for a person to grasp. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues by referring to the Quran as Kitab Al Hakim. Tilka Ayatul Kitab Al Hakim. These are the signs of the book of wisdom. The Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it in the Quran as a book of wisdom, a book of knowledge, a book of truth, Hakim. And of course, there's a correlation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about Luqman al-Hakim and the signs of the book that are Hakim. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to us about these signs of Allah. And here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Quran in one verse as Kitab al-Hakim, in another verse as Kitab al-Munir, the illuminating light, and in another one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it as Kitab al-Mubin, the clear, the book of Allah. The Quran is a very clear book. There are no inconsistencies. There are no contradictions in the Quran. And this is what makes it a wise book. This is what makes it a book of wisdom. If you find someone who's wise, you will see that this person does not have any inconsistencies in their life. This person, a person who's wise, they will not be telling lies. They're very clear, they're very honest, they're crystal clear in their talk. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, this is the book that is Hakim. Now, why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling the people of Mecca that the Quran is a book of wisdom? This is because, as we know, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was delivering the Quran to the people in Mecca. And the people in Mecca, they were living in a society that was filled with vices. And there were many soothsayers, fortune tellers, magicians, people saying talk that is gibberish, talk that has no meaning, talk that carries no meaning. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala later on, as we will point out in Surah Luqman, speaks about lahw al-hadith, the talk that is wasting time. So Allah is trying to differentiate. Allah is trying to create a dichotomy here where the Quran is a book of wisdom, a book of truth, a clear book, while all of the other talk, everything else, that is a talk that perhaps is not always truth, is not always truthful. The Quran is a book of truth, my dear brothers and sisters. Throughout history, 1400 years, the Quran has proven to be a book of truth. And this is what makes it a miracle. The miracle of the Quran is that the Quran is always relevant. There is never a time that the Quran does not become relevant. The Quran is always relevant. It's a book of truth. It's a book of wisdom. Perhaps I could be saying something right now. It may be true right now as I say it. But maybe 10 years down the line, maybe 100 years down the line, it's not going to be true. For example, I say right now, we don't have a vaccine for the coronavirus. This may be a word of truth right now, but in a couple of months, in a while, this will change. And inshallah, there will be a vaccine for the coronavirus. So this will not be a word of absolute truth. But the Quran is different. The Quran is absolute truth. The Quran, time, generations, all of this, it does not change the Quran. And it is always relevant. It is always something that is relevant and something that is clear. Now, the Quran says, تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْكِتَابِ الْحَكِيمِ. And these are the signs of someone who's wise. Someone who's wise should also be someone who's clear, someone who's always saying the truth, someone who is crystal clear in their message and in their life. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هدى ورحمة للمحسنين. The Quran is a book of hidayah, guidance, and a book of mercy. For who? For the muhsineen, for the good doers, for the ones who do good in their life. The Quran is a book of guidance and mercy for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran and Allah, is they are the ones who are clear. They are the ones who guide. Allah is the source of mercy. Allah is the source of all guidance in our lives. No one can come and guide you the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides you. And no one can have mercy upon you the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy upon you. And the source of all guidance that you have in life, and the source of all mercy that you have experienced and you see in life, goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in order for someone to be merciful, in order for someone to guide, they need to have several qualities. These are qualities that we lack. You need to be omnipotent. You need to have absolute power. And you need to have absolute knowledge. Omniscient. These are qualities that are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, هُدًا وَرَحْمَةً لِلْمُحْسِنِينَ. We know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides everyone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a mercy towards everyone. Everyone deserves and everyone receives a portion of the mercy of Allah and a portion of the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has guided every single one of us. Allah has blessed every single one of us with mercy. وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. And the mercy of Allah has encompassed everything. Everything. Even those who do not believe in God, they have received the mercy of Allah. And even the guidance, the hidayah. Allah says in the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى الَّذِي خَلَقَ فَسَوَّى وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَهَدَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created and guided. Even those people who when we look at them today, we see that they are not guided, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided them. Allah has guided us in numerous ways. Allah has guided me through the intellect. Allah has guided me in my creation. Allah has guided me in creating the perfect creation. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided me by giving me that internal navigation system, that fitrah, that innate subconscious that guides us and leads us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are all types of guidance and all types of mercy. However, the Quran, Allah says in the Quran, هُدًا وَرَحْمَةً لِلْمُحْسِنِينَ. The Quran is a book of guidance for the ones who choose to be guided by the Quran. If someone rejects the Quran, if someone places the Quran on their bookshelf, the Quran is a book of guidance, but it won't be a book of guidance for them because they are rejecting the guidance. So we understand that there are types, there are levels of guidance. One guidance, Allah gives it to everyone. Everyone deserves it and everyone will take it. But there's another more specific guidance, and that is the guidance of the Quran, the guidance of the faith, the guidance of Iman, the special guidance that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. And this is the guidance in this verse. It is for the muhsineen. You have to be a doer of good. You have to be a muhsin, someone who does good. Then you will be deserving and worthy of the guidance of the Quran and the mercy of the Quran. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Quran as a guidance for three categories. In one verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, when you first open the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alif Lam Mim, Dalika al-Kitabu la rayba fihi hudan lil-muttaqeen. Hudan lil-muttaqeen. It's a book of guidance for the pious. This is one. Another is the pious are the God conscious. You have to be God conscious. Second, in Surah An-Naml, Hudan wa Bushra lil Mu'mineen. It's a guidance and glad tidings for the Mu'mineen, for the believers, which is a level after you're aware, after you have conscious, You're aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you're a mu'min. Now you become a mu'min, and it's a book of guidance for you. And here, hudan wa rahmatan lil muhsineen. You also need to be a muhsin. You also, if you've believed, if you're aware of God, and if you believe in God, now you need to show. Your faith should be reflected in your actions. So how can my faith be reflected in my action? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes exactly who are the muhsineen. Who are the ones who this book is a book of guidance for them? Hudan wa rahmatan lil muhsineen. Three qualities, three characteristics of the believers. Alladhina yuqimuna as-salat wa yu'tuna az-zakat wa hum bil akhirati hum yuqinun. Three very important qualities which make you a muhsin according to the Quran. To be a doer of good. Ihsan is doing good. A muhsin is the one who does the good. The first, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. Those who uphold prayers. My dear brothers and sisters, there's a difference with someone who prays and someone who upholds prayer. When we recite the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, we say, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ قَدْ أَقَمْتَ الصَّلَاةِ. I bear witness that you upheld prayer, that you stood for the sake of prayer. Upholding prayer means caring for the prayer, giving the prayer the proper respect that it deserves. This is what makes you a muhsin. And when you are praying, you are doing ihsan. To who? Who is the first beneficiary of your prayer? Some people say, why does God need my prayer? God, He knows what's in my heart. Why does Allah need my prayer? The first beneficiary of your prayer is yourself, my dear brothers and sisters. We are the first ones who benefit from the prayers. When you pray, you're going to benefit. You're going to change your life. You're going to become a better individual. And when you do not pray, you're stripping yourself of the ability to communicate with the Lord of the universe. You're stripping yourself with the ability to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you're showing that you are ungrateful for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Allah has given us all of these things. He asks me to pray so that the prayer makes me a better person, so that the prayer helps me have vision and foresight in life. Allah says in the Quran, in ahsantum, the muhsin, someone who does good. We think when I'm doing something good, when I, for example, help someone out, when I do something good, I pray, I fast, I give charity, I consider myself a muhsin. I'm doing a favor upon other people. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something that's totally the opposite. Allah says in the Quran, in ahsantum, ahsantum li'anfusikum wa in asatum falaha. If you're doing good, if you're doing ihsan, you're going to be the first one who benefits from it. And if you do bad, you're going to be the first one who suffers as a result of the bad that you do. So this is the first sign. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. Second, وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ. Giving zakat, giving alms, giving charity, this is also a sign of the believer. This is a sign of the mu'min. The mu'min, the one who's a muhsin, the one who's connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the one who gives and helps out. A lot of us, we minimize faith to just salah and spirituality and dua and connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas the Quran tells us that faith and ihsan is not only for restricted to prayer and dua and supplications. These are things that are good for you. They help you in the afterlife. However, if you want help, if you want to be a muhsin, you have to pray and you have to help out people around you. And this is what Islam is. Islam teaches us to build two very important bonds. One is a vertical bond, a bond between you and your Lord. And second is a bond, a horizontal bond, a bond between you and people around you, people in your community. Allah says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ. You have to give zakat. You have to give alms. You have to think of the needy. You have to think of those who don't have. a portion of my money, I think of it as it's mine. But a portion of it does not belong to me, according to the Quran. Allah says in the Quran, وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ مَعْلُومٌ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ In your wealth, there's a part of your money belongs to those who are in need, those who are needy. Have we given? Are we reminded of giving to those who are in need? The whole purpose of the month of Ramadan, one of the most important philosophical and reasons for the month of Ramadan, what's the philosophy behind fasting? Hisham ibn al-Hakam, he asks Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, or Imam al-Sadiq, and the Imam tells him, so that you feel the hunger that other people feel. Throughout our whole life we're eating and we're drinking and we're enjoying our life. Sometimes we have to put ourselves in situations where we think of the others. And when we put ourselves in these situations, this is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ وَهُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. And the third quality of the believer is the one who believes in the Akhirah, the one who believes in the afterlife. This is a very important quality of a believer, of someone who's muhsin. If I want to be a doer of good, I have to pray, I have to help out others, and I have to believe and have certainty in the Akhirah, in the afterlife. Why is that? Why do I need to have belief in the Akhirah? Because when I believe in the afterlife, I am going to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold me accountable for every single thing that I do in this life. And when I have that thought in my mind, then I'm going to be very careful not to oppress. Then I'm going to be very careful not to abuse people. Some people, they have their own spiritual meditation and they give out money and they do things, but they don't believe in Allah. They don't believe in the afterlife. Why is believing in the afterlife so important? Believing in the afterlife and believing in the Akhirah is very important because you will be able to police yourself when you believe in the afterlife. Some people, they do good. They come and they give charity. They're very good. They're very kind with people. And then the moment they go home, you see that there's a totally different side. A totally different side. They change 180 degrees. Why? Because they're good. And their actions are for other people to see. In the masjid, I pray, I recite the Quran with a very beautiful voice. I come and I give charity and I do so much. But then when I go home, I become a totally different person. I start yelling, I start shouting, I start abusing, I start insulting. A muhsin is someone who's always muhsin. Someone who's always showing acts of kindness to everyone. And the one who believes in the Akhirah is someone who is always a muhsin. Someone who's always going to be very careful in their actions. Because you believe that there's a hisab, there's a kitab, there's accountability. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable for everything that we've done. And when I'm harmed, when I'm oppressed, I will also strengthen my faith. It will keep me going. I'm not going to give up. Because I believe in an afterlife. I believe that there is going to be accountability. If someone oppressed me, maybe I'm not able, maybe I'm not strong enough to be able to defend myself. But I know Allah is there. And this is the one who has the certainty. The one who has the certainty in the afterlife. This is why it's a very important quality to have. A man comes to Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam and he tells him, I have daughters that men are coming and they're proposing. They want to marry my daughters. Who should I give my daughter to? The Imam, he says, give your daughter to someone who has good akhlaq, good manners, and someone who believes in the Akhirah, someone who has strong faith, someone who has strong iman. And then the Imam, he adds, he says, because someone who has iman, even if they had problems, even if they had disputes with one another in the marriage, But their iman is going to make them be very careful not to transgress, not to oppress, not to say anything that might be harmful, that might be oppressive. And this is why it's very important to believe in the Akhirah. So Allah says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. These are the ones who will receive the guidance from the Quran, because these are the muhsineen, these are the doers of good. And then Allah says, Allah continues to describe them, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Those are the ones who are guided, who are continuously guided by their Lord, and those are the victorious ones. So if I want to be from amongst the victorious ones, if I want to be from the guided ones, then I have to be very careful that I have the connection with Allah, my salah, my zakat, and my certainty in the afterlife. These are what will make you a muhsin. If you become a muhsin, you will be a recipient of the guidance and the mercy of Allah, which is in the Quran. And then you will be from the wise ones. With that, we will end asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the ones who are wise. نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله. يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم أدخل على أهل القبور السرور. اللهم أغني كل فقير. اللهم أشبع كل جائع. اللهم اكسو كل عريان. اللهم اقض دين كل مدين. اللهم فرج عن كل مكروب. اللهم رد كل غريب. اللهم فك كل أسير. اللهم أصلح كل فاسد من أمور المسلمين. اللهم اشفي كل مريض. اللهم سد فقرنا بغناك. اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك. اللهم اقض عنا الدين واغننا من الفقر. إنك على كل شيء قدير. وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات.